session, focusing clearly on emerging economies and the implications of whatever is happening among emerging economies for the Middle East. I've already mentioned our three panelists, Dr. Felipe Larraín, Bascuñán, the former finance minister of Chile, Dr. Taeho, the former minister of trade for South Korea, both of whom have been at earlier geo-economics conferences, and therefore I'm delighted that you're again with us this morning. And Haihong Gao from Beijing, she had to change her flight and landed this morning in Bahrain at 7 a.m. And I had to cajole her into taking the second flight rather than cancelling her flight, because how can we have a conference on business opportunity and regional security and the global economy without someone from China speaking? So thank you very much, Haihong, for taking that second flight and making it in time. Right, let me begin with Dr. Felipe Larraín. 10 minutes.
Well, thank you very much. Good morning to everyone. A pleasure to be here at this IISS seminar forum here in Bahrain. I'm probably the only one from Latin America here. When you said, Sanjaya, that how can we have a forum without someone from China, I thought you were going to say also, how do you have a forum without someone from Latin America, you know? But
that's because anyway, I know you're going to be here, Felipe.
flying 28 hours to get here, you know, from Santiago, Chile, it also gives me some, you know, some perspective of how to approach the issue that I'm about to address, which is the issue of the emerging markets. And just not to repeat what has been said, we are facing, I'm going to try to put things a little bit on the perspective of certainly Latin America, but I will say a Latin America and Middle East comparison. Some of the things that have already been said, we are at the end of the commodity supercycle. We have a deceleration in China. Of course, these things are very much tied. And I would say the main thing here is not only the China's deceleration, but the change in the composition of growth. That we have a China that is more service-oriented, where consumption will be more important than investment. Consumption, it is absolutely essential that the Chinese economy changes, because with 50% of the aggregate demand on investment, that's not an equilibrium position. You need to have consumption growing with about 36% of aggregate demand. But this will have an implication over commodity demand, because consumption is less intensive on commodity than investment. So the fact that you have this change and the reduction in the overall growth will add to the pressures on commodities. The second thing is, I would say, has been mentioned, is the fundamental change in U.S. monetary policy, which we are about to see. Well, a fundamental change with a big change, one thing will happen in the U.S. and the other opposite thing will happen probably in the month of December in the next meeting of the ECB and the meetings of the Bank of Japan, which will imply an increase in the monetary stimulus on those economies. And this is the kind of thing that we are seeing. Coming from Latin America, there are very important parallels for natural resource-rich economies. We're all facing a major decline in export revenue, and we are facing severe implications in terms of lower growth, lower investment, pressures on, you know, on creating employment, and very dramatic, in some economies, fiscal effects. How do we deal with this new reality? I would say there are two hypotheses here. One is that this is cyclical, and the other that is structural. From all that we have been discussing this morning, I would go to the conclusion, and this would be the base from what I will discuss from this point on, is that we are facing a structural change. So this is not just a cyclical downturn on commodity prices. This is a permanent change. And I will put two things. Not only the oil, $110 a barrel, no, it's now 40 to 50, And in terms of copper, you know, where I come from, my part of the world, copper is really one of the major staples. So on copper, we're not seeing $3.30, we're seeing something between $2 and $2.50 per pound. So this is a new reality for every commodity exporter with different implications, but with the same qualitative effects. The effects on the, you know, on the markets are already saying a bit about what this is happening. The changes in commodity prices have not been the same for oil. For oil, the decline is about 60 to 65%. For metals, it's around 35 to 40. So this is a difference, and this difference has been carried through. If you are aware of the latest World Economic Outlook, the recent IMF publication in October of this year, there is an interesting piece of research included there. It is the fact that if you're a commodity exporter, it depends. If you're a non-oil exporter, you will suffer a decline in growth of about 1 percentage point from the average 2010-2013, let's say. And if you are an oil exporter, you will suffer 2.25 of a point decline in growth. So it's over twice the effect if you're an oil exporter. What is, are we about to sit down and say, okay, you know, there we are, you know, so we're about to face this? I think there are important changes. And let me point to at least four issues that we need to do. We need to help our economies implement structural change. This is not just about sitting down and letting, you know, whatever happens, but we need to do something proactive in this new environment. The first is fiscal institutions. It is true that government spending will need to adjust. It's impossible that we will keep, at least the growth rates will need to come down significantly. And I will suggest going on the way of some budget rules that are sort of long-term rather than just annually, yearly budget rules. More on a structural budgets that will take into account structural revenues over the long term. This will allow for a smooth transition, not just a huge cutoff on fiscal spending on 1 year. Some countries have already implemented this in Latin America. I'm not, you know, clearly aware of what's happening here in this part of the world, but in Latin America, yes, budgets are going on a sort of a longer term view. There is one advantage, one important advantage here in this region, is that sovereign wealth funds will significantly help, because they will provide some revenue, and the size of sovereign funds in the Middle East, in this part of the world, is much larger than what you see in Latin America. We have established some sovereign funds, but they're very tiny, so they could be depleted in a couple of years. That's very different from hundreds of billions of dollars of funds that have been established in this region. So first is fiscal institutions. Second is monetary exchange rate policy. Maybe this will look a bit, a bit simple, what I'm going to say. But what we are doing in Latin America is having the exchange rate do part of the job. You know, if you need to adjust your economy, if you need to do structural change, we have let our currencies depreciate, you know, and this is already providing incentive for other sectors to develop. It is cutting back on imports. Imports are more expensive, and it is providing incentives in the agribusiness, in agro-industrial, agricultural sector, industrial, in general manufacturing, because of a. And it seems to me, when I was coming here, I was looking at the exchange arrangements. They seem to be pretty inflexible in this part of the world. I mean, they're rigid, they're sort of, you know, tied to foreign currency, tied to the dollar, and I think my advice would be let the exchange rate move. Let's make more flexible exchange rates so that, you know, the adjustment in the economies can be helped by the exchange rate depreciation, which by and large, we have had countries in Latin America with, you know, 70, 50% depreciations. The pass-through to domestic pricing is relatively low because the cycle, you are in a relatively low part of the cycle. Let me, a third point that I would say, which is very important, infrastructure. It was touched in the previous panel. But I would stress this point, because if we need to do a structural change in our economies, we need to build up infrastructure. If you look at any countries, the indication of in all our countries, there are very dramatic opportunities in infrastructure. If we want to build our capacity to grow in alternative sectors that were not our staples, that were not oil, that were not copper, the metals, all that investment is in decline, then having a solid growth of infrastructure investment is important. And because we have so much strain on fiscal budgets, how do we finance infrastructure? I would strongly suggest to look into PPP, so public-private partnerships, so that you get the private sector involved into infrastructure section, infrastructure investment through. You need to have some kind of institutions, you need to have concessions, you need to have a legal framework that allows the private sector to invest and with a 20, 30-year horizon to be able to recapture the benefits of investment. I would also mention a few other things. What I'm saying here, this is a pretty structural change that we're facing in our economies. Productivity is one of the areas where we are lacking, and I think R&D spending and the investment in education are other essential parts. R&D spending is quite low. If I look at the figures that we have, less than half a percentage point of GDP is invested, and some countries invest only 0.1% of GDP. Well, the leaders, the guys, the countries where productivity is growing, let's say at 2 to 3 percentage points per year, well, they invest 3 to 4 points of GDP in research and development. So I think that's another important part. I would also argue with a bit of, you know, caution on one policy that typically comes when you need to do structural change, which is industrial policy. Countries, you know, there are some people who push forward and say, okay, we need to change the structure of the economy. So we have a few people who are mainly, you know, with all due respects, they're bureaucrats, and they're sitting in their offices, and what they're doing is saying, okay, now we need to go into petrochemicals, we need to go into different things. Be very careful of this way of approaching the structural change that we will be facing. In the end, what we're facing now, it won't be painless. I think it will be painful. What we're going through in emerging markets is not something that, it's not going to be completely smooth. There will be tensions, and of course the political ones, you know, that we're seeing and that are, you know, coexist with the economic tensions. But as an economist myself, I would say it's not only the politics stupid, it's also the economics, you know. It's, you need to combine the two. You need to do beware of what's happening in the political issues, the geo-economic issues, but also that we are under a major structural change in our economies, and it is the role of public policy to help smooth a process that won't be completely painless. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Felipe. Well, I guess when you say it's about public policy, whether it's fiscal correction, flexible exchange rates, infrastructure investment, R&D, all of that is policy, and policy is at the end of the day politics, which is why I said it's the politics stupid. Our next speaker, Dr. Taeho, former Minister of Trade for South Korea. 10 minutes.
Good morning. Thank you very much, Sanjaya. I would like to join the previous speakers for thanking forum organizers for inviting me to this wonderful and prestigious seminar. I'm not an expert on Middle East or GCC area. I'm an expert on trade. I was briefly trade minister of Korea, but I'm in academia for whole my life in the trade field. Well, let me say three things for this occasion. First of all, I want to explain, as a kind of trade expert, overall GCC and East Asian economic relations current status. That's what I want to do first. And then what are the main characteristics in that GCC and East Asian economic relations? And then lastly, I would like to, just like Felipe did, I want to have some suggestions to GCC countries based on East Asian experiences. That's what I want to do. Here, you know GCC countries. When I say East Asia, I deliberately include China, India, Japan, Korea, and ASEAN. I limited those countries to these East Asian countries. If I look at the overall trade relationship between the two regions, I can see very strong and substantial growth between the two regions. Generally speaking, coming into 21st centuries, overall both way trade has been steadily increasing, except two occasions. One is 2009, I don't need any explanation. And very currently, 2013 and 2014, our imports of oil slightly decreased. So other than that, the general trend is very healthy and growing. And particularly, the East GCC countries trade with China, India, and ASEAN, those are the emerging economies in East Asia, has been grown very substantially. And it is very interesting to see India's export share of Middle East or GCC countries. It rose to 16 to 18%, which is rather very high percentages for any countries I mentioned, but that's very interesting to note. And and also bilateral shares in both regions has been also increasing. And also at the same time, recently more East Asian companies are participating in the Gulf construction projects. Maybe Koreans are part of them too. And another observation I can make is labor mobility between the two regions, especially if I only say ASEAN countries, maybe the Filipinos are coming to ASEAN, not ASEAN, GCC countries, or you can also see some labor mobility between GCC and Southeast Asia nations. So those are the kind of very strong economic relations developed for the last 10 years or so. But what about the challenges for this GCC East Asian economic relations? We already hear many things in the first session, and I don't want to repeat, but I just summarize three challenges. One is world economic recession continues, and Chinese economic slowdown, and also oil price reduction and increased competition in the area of oil supply, which will be giving us some hard time for continuing this kind of a positive relationship between the two regions. Let me turn to the very key kind of feature you can find between the two regions, especially GCC and East Asian economic relations. The GCC and East Asian economic relations are excessively imbalanced in their focuses. I think you all know this. The GCC exports are mainly oil and oil-related products, while East Asian countries are exporting mainly non-oil products. In the case of oil exports from GCC, there are more than 60% of oil exports is going to the East Asia and countries I already mentioned. And also, GCC's investment in East Asian countries has been limited, while East Asian investment in GCC is concentrated in mainly a refinery project and some service areas. And also, I already said this, East Asian companies are coming more and more into the Gulf construction projects. Those are the key features I found between the two economic regions. And also, one more thing I can tell you is that compared to East Asia, GCC is less integrated within the region and also with the global economy compared to East Asian countries. So let me now turn to the final section of my presentation, which is the suggestions based on East Asian experiences. We already talked about many policy suggestions, but I also want to point out that economic restructuring is very important, especially in the GCC area, to promote value-added industrial products away from oil and oil-related products. So for that, I want to mention a couple of detailed suggestions. One is we have to design a comprehensive industrial development plan. Felipe mentioned that government says, arbitrarily select some few industries to develop. I'm not saying this, but you have to have a comprehensive industrial development plan. And if you do that, when you do that, it's very important to undertake outward-looking, in other words, export or trade-oriented kind of policies and industry-oriented policies. That's another thing I want to suggest. And when government intervene in this project, you do that based on technical and economic criteria, which is also very, very important. This is the experience we had in Korea too. And then, of course, you have to strengthen investment on education and human capital. Lastly, we also mentioned this this morning, productivity. In other words, promote R&D investment for technology improvement and innovation. We all say this morning China's economic growth is slowing down because of the world economic recession, many other reasons. But you have to remember, in 1992, economist Paul Krugman published a very short article saying the myth of East Asian miracle. In other words, he argued if you grow based on putting more inputs and inputs, then you will soon face the limitation of your growth. Maybe if you look at the average growth rate up until 1997, all East Asian countries is about 6% or 5%. But after 1997, 1998, except China, all the growth rate were halved. So we face some very serious limitation in terms of improving productivity. China joined this kind of dynamic East Asian region later. So maybe China is facing that kind of limitation. So I think it's very important to make investment so that innovation or technological improvement can be made to increase their productivity. And then another suggestion is providing more business-friendly environment. As far as Bahrain is concerned, I heard Minister Al-Jayani last night. He's doing fine in many, many aspects. Let me just say a few words. Reform regulations through accepting as much as possible global standard so that you can increase the transparency, consistency, or predictability of the policies, which is very important for not only domestic companies but also foreign companies. And continue to expand market liberalization in the area of goods and also services, which will enhance competition in your domestic region, which can actually reduce rent-seeking activities, which is very prevalent in this area. And also trade facilitation is very important. At the WTO, we agreed upon trade facilitation agreement, especially the customs and logistics related area. You need to have a huge reform there, and also promote foreign direct investment inflows to non-oil industrial sectors to help diversifying the industrial sectors in GCC area. And the third point is that I hope to see the strengthening the GCC area's intra-regional economic integration. In other words, you have to upgrade the GCC to a comprehensive and very high quality regional integration so that you can also enhance the competition among members. Introduce investment liberalization chapter to promote the global value change among the GCC business entities. And finally, introduce even regulatory convergence or harmonization among members, which will make GCC integration or cooperation much more efficient. Lastly, I want to suggest that maybe GCC should diversify its economic external economic relations with other parts of the world. I know GCC has been negotiating for so-called mega FTAs with China or India or Japan, Mercosur and some other countries, including Korea, but for GCC Korea, FTA negotiation has been stalled for many years. It should be resumed or completed as early as possible, but you should aim for high quality FTA. And also, why you are doing it with the individual members of East Asian countries? Why not we should try to have a more regional mega RTA like GCC and RCEP? RCEP is the East Asian Economic Cooperation negotiations, including ASEAN 10 countries, China, Japan, Korea, and Australia, India, New Zealand. So why not region to region, more bigger RTA, which will make much more flexibility for the business people? And lastly, because I'm a trade expert, I want to emphasize that GCC countries should more actively participate in the multilateral as well as plurilateral trade negotiation. In other words, Doha round is dying. I think we need some new ideas how to revive this kind of negotiations. I think I want to see some more active participation or suggestions from GCC countries, and in information technology agreement, and trade and services agreement, environmental goods agreement, for those kind of plurilateral agreements, I hope to see more active participation from GCC countries. Let me stop here. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Dr. Bhag. I think your final point about GCC, RCEP, a greater trade integration between West and East Asia and Southeast Asia is a idea whose time, I believe, has come or will soon come. It's an important suggestion. It of course requires, my guess is, a little more integration within GCC for the region to be able to reach out to the rest of Asia. I think despite all the ups and downs in regional economies, the long-term future of West Asia is really with East and Southeast Asian economies and South Asian economies. And therefore, I'm glad you mentioned that as a policy idea. I should add before I invite Hai Hong that my favorite story about Korea and GCC is when Iraq invaded Kuwait, over 100 Korean citizens rushed into the Korean embassy, and along with the diplomats, they were holed up in the embassy. And I was told that a Korean aircraft landed in the Kuwait airport, waiting to evacuate these people. And the Kuwaiti authorities were not ready to guarantee the safety and security of the transportation of 100 Korean citizens from the embassy to the airport. So one of the Korean executives from Hyundai said, look, Hyundai is very popular in Iraq, so we'll fly Hyundai flags and say Hyundai Staff Association on the bus and drive in these two buses, which is what they did. And they reached airport safely. So Korea has been here for a long time, and Korean brands have been here for a long time. So you are the right person to reflect on this region. Thank you very much for being here. Finally, for this morning, Dr. Hai Hong Gao, head of director of Research Center in International Finance at the China Academy of Social Sciences.
Thank you, Dr. Baru. Without your help, I wouldn't be here now. And I'm very glad to be here to present my view. I think in the first session, there was a very fruitful discussion on Chinese economy already. And so I'm going to divide my focus on two themes. One is still, I would like to highlight my view on Chinese economy. And another is the RMB internationalization, which I think is one of the most important strategy China is pursuing in the last years. So first, I think the key word, of course, for Chinese economy is slowdown. We heard of this many, many times. But I think the real question is how dangerous it is. And if you look at the drivers from demand side, the export contribution to GDP has been a negative for some years, and if it's positive, and very much at very marginal level. So China is no longer an export-driven economy already. And secondly, if you look at the fixed investment, which used to be the single driver for growth, now down to the lowest in 22 years. And the third driver is the consumption. And consumption is quite difficult to understand because if you look at the figure, the share is quite high, accounting like 60%. It grows steady in the past years. But if you break it down, the household consumption is very low. So this is really worrisome because China really wants to shift its growth pattern from the investment-driven to a consumption-driven. But household consumption needs to be increased. And another concern is that the policy response to slow down this year, there are six times a policy rate cut already. And China also launched the $2 trillion infrastructure projects. And the currency devaluation is another policy. So all those efforts actually has a very limited effectiveness. So what's wrong with this? I think there is discussion, about the cyclical issues and structural issues. I think currently there is a mismatch between the problems and the policy measurements. So now I think China is in a period of shifting the focus from demand side to supply side. So there are tremendous discussions nowadays in China about how to boost the economy from the demand side factors. And one thing I'd like to highlight is that it's quite remarkable because recently Chinese government launched the 13th five-year plan. And one of the key guidelines is the 6.5% growth rate, which is much lower. If you think of over the past 30 years, I think the growth rate was like 10% high. But this figure is lower, but it's better, and it's more realistic because it means that Chinese government really wants to focus on the long-term structural change. And structural change is happening. If you look at the supply set factors, first of all, the service sector has already surpassed industrial sector for several years. And I think the gap even widening this year. And if that trend continues, certainly the growth rate is going to be on a lower path. And also, I think the Chinese government launched a number of policies aimed to boost the economy from the supply side reform, such as the liberalized factor prices, lands, assets, and labor, and to encourage innovation. Innovation is a key word nowadays in China, and also to change the rule of the government. And to get more input on the social reforms, like the hukou system is going to change. It's changed already, but it's more change in the years ahead. And education reform, medical care reform, and all those efforts, I think, aim to generate growth potentials from the supply side. And it's more structural, and it's more fundamental. So overall, I think the Chinese economy in short term, the risk is still there. If you look at the debt to GDP ratio, it's quite high, and especially on firm level, and it's historically high. And also there are other problems like shadow banking, and the risk of like capital outflows. And even with the exchange rate policy regime shift, there are many speculations on this policy. Definitely this policy is the right move, in my opinion, because the PBOC actually has a long view on the flexibility of its currency, and it's probably just at the wrong timing, because during that time, the Chinese stock market was in a huge downturn, and that generated the panic in the market. And in the stock market, it's just like, you know, the nightmare, but in a forex market, it's overshooting. So Chinese currency actually is moving on a flexible path, and I think all those policy measures will help to prevent so-called hard landing. I don't think there is going to be a hard landing. I agree. I heard the first presenter said he also said the hard landing is unlikely. So the second topic is on Chinese currency. I think this topic is more or less related to the question raised by the Chinese colleague from Beijing and in the first session, because of global governance. I think, you know, the Chinese yuan internationalization, I would like to call it RMB strategy, is not just related to a currency's internationalization. It also related to many dimensions. And first of all, it is of course the natural result of China's increasing power in the world. And you may remember in 2009, Chinese Central Bank Governor Zhou Xiaochuan mentioned about the super sovereign reserve currency proposal. And that proposal actually reflects the China is extremely dissatisfied with the existing international financial system where dollar dominates. And China, with a huge amount of reserves, suffering capital losses tremendously. And secondly, I think the RMB strategy is more meaningful for China itself. I mean, if you look back to the process of the internationalization since 2009, when China first formally relaxed restrictions in trade settlement, and the path China went through actually is about opening and liberalization. And this is pretty much like Japanese experience in the 1980s, when Japanese wanted to internationalize yen. So I think we call it a committed device, like the WTO. You know, one of the most important success in China is the entry of WTO. And why it is so successful? Because the entry of WTO actually invited foreign competitions and pressure for domestic reform. And this is really workable in China. And RMB strategy is the same, it has the same function. And of course this year you see the SDR issue again. China wants to include its currency into the SDR basket. And this actually has become a committed device for domestic reform. The exchange rate policy change is part of this, and more opening in a money market is part of it. And so I think all those changes actually attach to Chinese domestic reforms and opening. And now, from a more a broader view, I think the RMB internationalization actually is a part of the global reserve currency diversification. I mean, from the international point of view, the international monetary system is like a top-down design, but nowadays we don't have any of it. So the currency strategy actually is a bottom-up effort, and this is really meaningful for both of the world and China. So overall, I think China's economic structure transformation is very likely to happen. So it's the RMB project, it's a long-term project, and it's too early to say the outcome, but I think the impact could be very profound. And the business opportunity, of course, is tremendous, because the RMB offshores, you know, running from Hong Kong to Singapore and London, and now I think the Middle East, Doha has the clearing center, and I think Bahrain is going to be another offshore, and there is a lot more business opportunities, and this is beneficial for everyone. So I'm going to stop there. Thank you.
Thank you, Hai Hong. Now we have 35 minutes before we break for coffee. That will allow you to ask the questions that you have. I have one question for each of our panelists, so let me set the ball rolling. Felipe, you spoke about Chile's own problems with decline in copper prices, and in general, Latin American countries like the Middle East are also commodity exporting economies. So the downturn in the commodity supercycle, how is it likely to impact the Latin America GCC interaction? Because your demand for oil is likely to go down as much as demand for metals and foodstuffs. So would you like to add something on that? My question to Dr. Bark is, Korea certainly is also an export economy, and we've heard a lot about China's economic slowdown, oil commodity exporters facing an economic slowdown. What does it mean for Korea as an exporting economy? So what would be Korea's trade strategy going forward into the next year? And finally, for Hai Hong, my question is, it's interesting that you, of course, as you mentioned, RMB internationalization is a long-term project. And China is set on a course, but I think the big question being asked by several analysts is whether this year's slowdown, which as in the earlier discussion, there was views that the slowdown could be actually as much as 2 to 3% growth rather than 6% or 7%, but whatever the numbers are, does the slowdown this year have any implications for the timetable for RMB internationalization? Are we likely to see a slowing down of the timetable given the implications for management of the current account and capital account liberalization in China? With those three questions, I will invite now a couple of questions from the audience, come back to the panel and go back again to the audience. Yes, Tadashi Maeda.
Thank you, Sanjaya. I have the question. My question is going to Dr. Hai Hong Gao on China. You refer to that some Japanese experience in the 1980s in terms of the internationalization of the currency. But the situation at that time in Japan is quite different from the situation in China nowadays. Because you talk about the SDR, so to include the RMB into SDR. But SDR is not currency itself, but SDR is a kind of measurement tool. And there are three key the conditions to be included into the SDR. Is one is a currency in a foreign reserve in other countries, to what extent the other countries hold the RMB as a component of foreign reserve. Second, the currency denominated in trade, because obviously China is a very big trading partner to other countries, but to what extent the RMB can be utilized in trade not just only the China and the other countries, but the third countries in between. Third is to what extent RMB is devaluated in a capital market. In the 1980s, in Japanese cases, the Japanese yen was already the part of ACL at that time. So you said that the long-term the project you refer to as a RMB internationalization. But the question is that what is the sequence? How you describe the sequence, and also that how many years going to take of each steps to be taken? This is my question. Thank you.
Thank you. Yes, sir. Two of you, one after the other. Yeah.
Thank you very much, Baru. One comment and also a question. My comments actually, it seems a kind of a buzzword about the Chinese economy is slowing down. But the point is the growth rate is one thing, but the composition, as a previous speaker mentioned, is another. Particularly when China is shifting from the export-driving economy to a domestic consumption, service-oriented economy, that's very important. And from this perspective, I think approximately 7% remains very impressive. Given this 7%, it can be translated or can be equivalent about 18% 10 years ago about the Chinese economy, given that last year China's economy already crossed the $10 trillion. So the basis is huge. With regard to the diversification, it is another buzzword about GCC economy and others. I think there's one thing, particularly the One Belt and the One Road initiative may present a very good opportunity, because during China's conversation with the Arab state, with the Middle East countries, energy sector cooperation is one thing, but also it identifies other areas. For example, the infrastructure building, trade and investment facilitation, high-tech area, nuclear energy, space, satellite, and new energy. So I think all these can serve as a platform for diversification, which serves the interest of both China and Middle East countries. My question to Dr. Bog. And in your presentation, you made a proposal that why not adopt a region-to-region approach? I mean, GCC and East Asia as a two region to get together. I think my question is that can you elaborate a little bit more? Because I think even in East Asia's case, our regional integration is moving very slow and not as fast as we expected. Thank you very much.
Okay, thank you. Actually, I have many questions, but now we would like to narrow down to the one question to the Dr. Bach saying. I'm Xu Xiaojie from China Academy of Social Sciences. I have learned a lot from your presentations about GCC and Asia bilateral cooperation or interregional cooperation. You have many suggestions for GCC how to get together to work with the country in the East Asia against the new realities. But my question is, do you have any suggestion for the countries in East Asia how to get it together? Because we have many talks about the cooperation within the sub-region and its relation with other parts of the world for GCC, for example. How to get it together? We have many talks, but the action is less. Did you have any words about the action? Thank you.
Thank you. I'll take one more question, come back to the panel and go back to the audience. Nilam Deo.
Thank you. My question is to Dr. Gao, and it relates to the One Belt, One Road initiative. There are some estimates of investment, and of course they are all widely different, but according to perhaps the largest, it involves an investment of around $1 trillion over the next 10 years or whatever. So the question is, how does that impact the intent of the Chinese to change their economy to a consumption-driven economy if there are going to be these huge investments which would drain the fiscal resources of the government?
I have three or four names listed here, but before that, let me come back to the panel, and then we'll go back to the audience. Felipe?
Yes. On the issue of how this commodity decline impacts the, you know, Latin America's demand for oil. First, if we are looking at Latin America, I will make two important distinctions and two groups in Latin America. The first is the oil exporters in the region, because the region is very diverse. Well, you talk about Latin America, but you have Venezuela, you have Colombia, you have Ecuador, and you have Mexico as important oil producers and exporters. A second divide, so that's one divide. These guys are more into the camp of, you know, they're facing a very similar situation with important differences. Mexico is a very diversified economy, although still an oil exporter, very diversified, and Venezuela is a highly non-diversified economy with a major social, economic, and political crisis. So those are different things, but they're both oil exporters. Colombia, 50% of exports in Colombia are oil. And Ecuador is on oil, and one of the countries in Latin America that is not floating rate, but is dollarized. So it says oil and is dollarized, which compounds the problem. On the other hand, you have a bunch of countries, you know, Chile, Peru, which are, you know, metal exporters. And you have another divide, the Atlantic region and the Pacific. And the Pacific Alliance, which is four countries, Mexico, Colombia, Peru, and Chile, which is doing much better than the Atlantic. In fact, you have major crises in Venezuela, as we mentioned, Brazil in a very significant recession. This is the largest recession in Brazil, two consecutive years of negative growth since the 1930s, since the Great Depression. So it's not a minor thing. And you have Argentina, stagnant, but with, I must say, better prospects after the election of Mauricio Macri as the president who is coming in. It's going to be sworn in the first days of December. So there is a very significant and fundamental change. What I would say is that even though Latin America, if you take the group of countries in the Pacific Alliance, have declined in terms of their growth rates, they're still growing. They're growing between 2 and 3%. And because the price of oil has declined so much, you know, it's not that oil demand is declining. In fact, oil demand is increasing in this country. So the fact that you have these countries growing, average growth for the region, so that's why I warn you to beware of averages, you know, average growth in Latin America, negative, but that's highly dependent on Brazil first, and then second on Venezuela. Venezuela is going to drop by about 8% this year, so 8% decline of GDP. And Brazil is going to be around 3%, so 3% decline. So when you look at average numbers, beware that you have to consider one thing for the countries in the Atlantic, the other things for the countries in the Pacific. So that would be my. Let me just mention one thing on the internationalization of the renminbi, if I can, to you, Gao, Haigong. I understand the intention of the internationalization of the renminbi, yet, and I also understand that there are liberalization measures in financial liberalization that go in that direction, but you need to do more on the flexibilization of the currency. If you truly want the renminbi to become an international currency, you need to have you know, less intervention and go towards a floating renminbi. How do you see this process evolving? Is this something that we will see in our lifetimes, or we will have to wait for another generation to see a floating renminbi?
Can I respond? I'll be very brief. As to the Dr. Baru's question on Korea's future plan, while the exports are slowing down everywhere. In fact, the role of export in economic growth and generating more jobs in Korea is declining very heavily. However, if you consider the size of Korea, South Korean economy is only 1.7% of the global GDP. So to further enhance our economic status, we must also export. I mean, we must utilize the world economic market. I want to emphasize three things. Korean government is emphasizing this these days. Three major roles to play by SMEs, small and medium enterprises, and also foreign direct investment in Korea, and also service sectors are the future industry to not only enhance the export and also the economic growth and also generate more employment. And for that, we want to emphasize that Korea has 15 FTAs covering United States, EU, India, recently China. It all add up to more than 73% of the world GDP, the partner countries GDPs, followed by Chile and Peru and Korea. So we want to use this FTA network to encourage our small and medium-sized companies to be a global companies, and also we want to induce more foreign direct investment so that they can use this kind of FTA network. I'm only talking about in the area of trade. So it may sound a little bit awkward, but we must do some more effort to link our economy to the global economy. That's the only strategy you can do. Regarding this regional integration, I think I can answer both questions as one time. I know in East Asia, we have China-Japan-Korea FTA negotiations still going on. RCEP is not completed. RCEP is, I already said that, ASEAN plus 3 plus India, Australia, New Zealand. It started in 2012. It is not moving very well. But the thing is, the TPP, Trans-Pacific Partnership, also 12 countries are participating. They are completed. I don't know when this can be implemented because still it has a lot of complexity domestically. But what I'm saying is here, without this kind of regional integration in East Asia, I mean, East Asia, we talk about the slowdown, but this most dynamic potential economies in the world, we must enhance our efficiencies for companies, for global value chains, all kinds of things. So I think we need a leadership, and we must have a commitment to open up at least among our region first. Just like a GCC must do much more integration within GCC, and then just like a TPP, why not rather than bilateral FTAs, why not we have a we want to have a region-to-region FTA. It may take quite some time, but it's useful to start discussing. That's what I want to suggest. So we want to really emphasize that the big countries in East Asia, especially China and Japan and also Korea, should speed up their own negotiation for three countries. We are now having some political disputes and political issues, but aside from that, I think unless without the CJK integrating, we cannot talk about anything else in the East Asian region. So I just want to emphasize that this is very important at the moment.
Thank you. Hai Hong?
Yeah, Dr. Barrow's question, implication of the slowdown on R&D project, I think we have to differentiate the market appetite and the policy dimension. And for the market appetite, I think it's negatively impact because the previous idea, the RMB, why the market like to use the RMB? Because the RMB on the appreciating path. And I think the recently the depreciation of the RMB actually is negatively impact the market appetite. If you look at the offshore market, liquidity is shrinking. So this is really happening, and it could have a negative impact on the pace of the RMB internationalization. But for the policy dimension, I think the impact is minimum. Because of this SDR agenda, again, the Chinese government really wants to have a yes answer from the IMF. So how to get a yes answer to opening, to open more and to liberalize more? And there are many new steps towards its opening recently, even though the domestic market is in turmoil. And the Japanese experience of upgrade conditions is different, and the key is the sequencing. I think there are also two dimensions. One is the functions of a currency. I think three basic functions: reserves, union account, and medium of transaction. I think the reserve currency, the function, is probably very difficult to get. And for the time being, the RMB included in the SDR is a boost in this area. Many people believe it's a symbolic, but I don't think it's just, it's actually a milestone for Chinese, because the Chinese currency has the MF support. This is remarkable. This is different from before, because, you know, it's like the international market has the credibility from this inclusion. And another is the policy sequencing. This is a core debate in China with regard to RMB internationalization. And it's also the question you mentioned, the flexibility of exchange rate. Because normally we see key policies. One is the flexibility of exchange rate, and the second is capital account liberalization. And the third one is the domestic financial market. And which goes first? It's always debate. And it seems that in the past, the openings always move faster than the rest of the currencies. And many economists set a warning, a signal, this is too risky in a circumstance of the Fed policy, the Fed rate rising, and the liquidity going on in the global market. So this is a very important issue, and I don't think even now we don't have very clear agenda. But for the agenda for the RMB internet nationalization, I think the 2020 is a key year of all the project. At least it's a commitment by the government, and you'll see before that there are more opening and reform. And One Belt, One Road, actually, I try to avoid this because Dr. Barrow asked me, you should talk about this. I try to, but this is certainly is a very important issue. And because I'm an economist, it seems like even for me, it's very difficult to calculate the benefit of this project in the framework of the benefit cost. So actually, I think I agree, there's no help for the consumption-driven model. I think to see it as a vision might be helpful to understand it. And of course, you know, it's quite sizable in terms of even the number of countries geographically. So this is a vision, it's a regional vision of the new leader in China. And there are more contents, even now I think it's just keep changing, and it's so dynamic. So I'll leave this for other experts on this, and identify that this is a very important issue.
Thank you, Hai Hong. Next question, Memdu Karakluksu from Turkey. I can hear you, but I don't think it's working, but I can hear you. Raise your voice. Yeah, it's working now.
Now it's all right. Okay, good. Let me go back to Felipe's presentation to sort of push him on two premises that he expressed with some certainty. The first one is that the commodity, the low commodity prices, is a structural certainty. That's, it's there, and we'll have to deal with it. How certain are we about that? Because on the supply side, we hear about low investment due to low prices, which might in a few years catch up. And then on the demand side, China may not be the final growth frontier globally. We may have other big stories coming in India, in Africa, where we might have another demand push for commodities. So that's the first premise I wanted to test. The second one, assuming that there is indeed a structural low commodity price period ahead of us, you suggest floating exchange rates as the policy's proposal. Now, is that a blanket proposal, or do you think some countries, some commodity exporting countries, may have different responsiveness, readiness to sudden or fast depreciation of their currencies? And also globally, systemically, if all commodity exporting countries were to depreciate, is that a scenario you think globally we want to deal with, we can deal with? And I'll stop there.
Thank you. Yes, sir. You wanted to ask? Yeah.
One more try in here. This question to Mr. Bark. It's a brilliant idea, this region-to-region cooperation, although, as you have heard, it's just full of difficulties and both within each region and between the two regions. But let's move from region-to-region to another level, which is much more manageable and possible, country to country. And I have here in mind your own country, South Africa, a rising star in East Asia, and the country that I come from, United Arab Emirates, another rising economic tiger of the future, maybe, in the making here. Do you see any growing cooperation between these two rising stars as a role model, maybe in later on, for a more regional integration between the two, East Asia and West Asia? Thank you very
Thank
much.
Thank you. Yes, sir.
My question is to Dr. Bark. We hear a lot about these FTAs and that countries should follow them. Now, I understand this from exporting countries' point of view. But for countries like GCC, where they only export commodities, oil, what's the advantage? No one really explains in depth what's the advantage for the GCCs from these FTAs.
Thank you. Alia?
I have a question for Dr. Gao and one for Mr. Bark. For Dr. Gao, I mean, even if the RMB internationalization looks to be a few years away, but looking at this from the perspective of oil exporters in the region, but many of the Middle Eastern economies in general that have their exchange rate pegged to the dollar, on top of oil price pressure and the need, which I agree, to sort of rethink the exchange arrangement, there is this issue of the renminbi, given that China at least is one of the main and growing trade partner for these countries. So how do you suggest for these countries to think about this sort of long-term objective? How should Middle Eastern oil exporter deal with the perspective of RMB internationalization in terms of reserve management decisions? The second for Dr. Bark, maybe Dr. Gao would want to answer. I mean, there are also an important maybe structural change in the region in terms of sort of the rise of Iran as another sort of oil exporter if the nuclear deal starts being implemented. And we clearly see many of the Asian countries, particularly those that have already previous to the sanctions, strong relations with Iran, wanting to increase investment ties also. The last announcement, I don't know if it is part of the One Belt, One Road, is the huge sort of announcement that China would want to actually build a rail from China down to Iran, which was quite interesting. So how do you look at the region from an Asian perspective, in light of potential changes of either competition, at least today given the geopolitics of the region, but forward cooperation by widening basically the trade ties to include potentially regional cooperation between Iran and the GCC that maybe Asia can encourage? Do you think that's at all something that we should think about?
Right, thank you. I have two quick questions and then we'll have to wind up. Soumitra.
Yeah, it's again about RMB internationalization. The price discovery method for currencies, and of course without a flexible currency, you cannot have internationalization. Price discovery mechanism works with the capital market, doesn't work for the current account. It is not only a payment device, there are lots of products that have to be done. One of the problems with China has been that the bond market has not been liberalized. Outsiders cannot invest in the Chinese bond market. And there is a small enclave market in Hong Kong, which is very limited. It doesn't really allow price discovery. Now, my question essentially is that the new kind of close relationships between China and Britain, which has emerged in the last visit of Chinese president to London, does it presage a situation where the UK's considerable financial experience and depth could actually be used to catalyze the internalization of the RMB? There are some problems about banking regulations in UK, whether it can get out, if the referendum comes through and UK actually leaves the EU, there's a different situation. But I think, is there a potential for a Hong Kong on the Thames on a much grander scale, which actually might allow RMB internalization in a truer form?
Hong Kong on the Thames. Bill Emmett?
Only if we could have the climate. Quick question about debt and exchange rates, probably for Felipe, but maybe also for Dr. Bach. We know that there's a very high, been a big increase in corporate debt in emerging economies, including a big increase in dollar-denominated corporate debt. Where that dollar-denominated corporate debt coincides with the previously rigid exchange rate system, how would you as finance minister or trade minister manage that process? What would be your recommendation for how you deal with that overhang, which I think is shared by a lot of countries?
Well, I'll really allow only one yes, sir. You've been very enthusiastic, so very quick.
Thank you very much. My question goes to Dr. Bach concerning the TPP, I mean Trans-Pacific Partnership. I think in East Asia, they have many regional grouping cooperation, APEC, and then ASEAN plus one, ASEAN plus three, and now the latest with the TPP. I don't know. All the cooperation, the regional grouping will be complement each other or will be conflicting each other. And then the second question to Dr. Gao.
I'm really sorry. We are running out of time. One question, that's it. I'll have to come back to the panel very quickly, 1 minute each. You don't have to answer all the questions, but I think the key issues raised by these questions, if you can answer, 1 minute each.
Thank you, Sanjaya. On the first issue of how certain are we that this is a structural change in commodity prices? I would say I feel more secure of saying that for oil than I am for copper, you know, just to mention. And the one reason for this is that, on both cases, we have demand, you know, but on one case, we have a major technological change that was discussed in the first panel. So I would say I feel more certain that we are, although I think in both, because the issue is, and you were mentioning, well, China is not, China may not be driving demand as it used in the past, but then maybe other places. Well, if India, for example, will rise and growth rates if India will be the new China, then of course we'll be in a different thing, in a different scenario. But I don't think that China can be easily replaced as a demand for commodities. So that's why I also think that it is a structural issue for copper. although it's clearer for oil. On the second issue of floating rates, will I give as a blanket, let me just say a personal confession. I've been an advisor to, in my whole life, I have advised 18 governments. I never give a blanket advice, you know. I always go look at the country, you know, the specifics, and I must say that I've never advised a Middle East country. I've advised mainly countries in Latin America, and I've been a finance minister in Chile. So my experience is mainly with emerging markets from that part of the world, and from with Eastern Europe, which I, where I also work, but not here. Well, the one thing that I would say is that my advice would be, I would move in the direction of floating rates, but with some kind of long-term fiscal rules, because you need to have an anchor. The moment you give away the anchor of the exchange rate, you need to have an alternative anchor, and it, you need to have a very clear view long-term on fiscal policy, not just a year to year. Second, I would move into inflation targeting and autonomous independent central banks. And I would say that combination would be what I would advise, not just blanket floating rates, because maybe what they will do, they will create, you know, maybe a lot of inflation if you don't have the other anchors in. So maybe I'll have the opportunity to come and work in this area of the world and give a more concrete answer.
Good.
On the corporate debt, just to for Bill, this is not, I looked at this very closely. In the case, we never had this kind of thing with a, you know, huge buildup of corporate debt, but I'm aware that some economies do have it. The two very brief things is, first, we try to issue debt, and we started issuing the first bond, sovereign bond, in local currency, in our own pesos, you know, placed in New York. You know, we did that while we were in government because we thought that the concern here with floating rates is that you have the corporate debt issued in dollars, you know, and then you have a huge increase in the exchange rate, and you have a whole problem with balance sheets, you know, and with liquidity and so on. So that's what I would say. So I would be worried and concerned if I see a huge buildup of corporate debt within, and if it's foreign currency denominated.
Yeah, Dr. Bach, telegraphic in your reply, you can elaborate over coffee.
Well, I will be very brief. First of all, we must understand countries are competing for having as many FTA as possible. Why? Because our first best solution is not working. In other words, WTO is not effectively working. That's why we are living in a second best world or even third best worlds. That's why they are competing to actually have a more trade with partners, but inherently you are discriminating against non-partners. So we have to keep that in mind. So for UAE and Korea, the single kind of bilateral FTA is a good idea. Before we talk about the region, you know, regional integration, maybe it's a good case to try. And why FTA is for importing countries mainly? Because if you have FTA, then that means that you have more liberal trading system that makes your own economy much more attractive for foreign investors. In other words, if you have FTA, naturally, from your partners or from other countries, foreign direct investments coming in because they are guaranteed about free trade. That's the benefit of having FTA. Iran, of course, Korea want to already talking to Iran among business people or even government delegation are visiting Iran to boost up our relations. And the corporate debt, original sin, I'm not an expert, but you should avoid expectation formed about devaluation or big exchange movement, and also you have to avoid contagion. You may be very healthy economy, but you may be attacked by, you know, your neighboring countries. I think these two things are very important to consider. And TPP is not complementary to each other. Actually, TPP divided ASEAN into two. Only four ASEANs are belonging to TPP. Remaining six ASEANs are not part of TPP. So it creates a lot of difficulties as a regional trade diversion, which is negatively affecting non-participating countries. I will stop here. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Bach. Hai Hong.
Yeah, the RMB denominates all your transactions, I think it is difficult. Because as you said, the RMB has to be an anchor for the country. But it's not possible. I mean, in the Middle East, actually, there are bilateral swap lines between central banks and also clearing center already here. And this, I think, is so dynamic. We'll wait and see. And another one is with regard to Hong Kong. I think London. London is a great help because London is a great offshore center. And RMB, actually, Hong Kong is the played an important role in the beginning of the RMB strategy. But London, I think, is a more market-driven place. And it's free in train, and it's pure market principle. So that is really a great help. But RMB influence is really in Asia. The fundamental link is crucial. So what I would suggest is just look at integration in Asia, and Chinese currency is growing, not only in a reserve currency, but also in the securities and financial transactions. So this is the offshore market is just has a very limited role in the beginning, but later on, the Shanghai is another center. So there is going to be a competition between among the financial centers with regard to RMB internet. This is a good thing.
Thank you. I'm really grateful to the panelists for being brief and allowing me to finish just 2 minutes behind schedule. I must apologize to the gentleman whom I had to cut short, but and also the others who raised their hand. But we have now 25 minutes over coffee, and you can meet the panelists over coffee and get more elaborate replies to your questions. I have one announcement to make before we disperse for coffee. We have, after lunch, we have five different group sessions. The first group, group one, which is on oil and energy markets, will meet in a room called Sky 4 on the 51st floor. My colleagues will guide you. There are signs will let you know which are the lifts. There are two dedicated lifts to take you to the 50th and the 51st floor. So the first group, oil and energy markets in Sky 4, which is a meeting room on the 51st floor. The second group on strategic risk, organized crime and cybersecurity will meet just behind this room in Al Bahrain on the other side of the partition. The third group, which is on impact of economic sanctions on business, will meet in the meeting room called Sky 2, which is on the 50th floor. The fourth group, opportunity and challenge of GCC skills gap, will meet in Sky 1, again on the 50th floor. And the fifth group, Asian economies and the Gulf, will meet in Sky 3, again on the 50th floor. So we have three meeting rooms on the 50th floor, one meeting room on the 51st floor, and one meeting room just behind here. And if you have any difficulties, my colleagues are outside. I am there. We'll help you guide after lunch. We now break for coffee, meet exactly at 12, and my colleague Sir John Jenkins will chair the next plenary session.